5, where we pick it up. This is where Jesus calms the storm. That day when evening came, he said to his disciples, "Let's go over to the other side." Leaving the crowd behind, he took him along, just as he was in the boat. There were also other boats with them. When a furious squall came up and the waves broke over the boat so that it was nearly swamped, Jesus was in the stern, sleeping on a cushion. The disciples woke him up and said, "Teacher, don't you care if we drown?" He got up, rebuked the wind, and said to the waves, "Quiet, be still." Then the wind died down and it was completely calm. Then he turned to his disciples and he said, "Why are you so afraid? Do you still have no faith?" They were terrified and asked each other, "Who is this that even the wind and the waves obey him?" And God added his blessings to this word. For those visitors here today, when I do this, it's a signal you're only here for 2 more hours. Just kidding. Boy, I miss that other mic. So hopefully everyone can hear me on this one. You know, we come here on Father's Day to honor our fathers, but we also need to take a look at our mothers as well. Remind me of a story that I read. A mother was out walking with her 4-year-old daughter. The child picked up something off the ground and started to put it in her mouth. And the mother took it away. Said, "Don't do that." The child said, "Why not?" "Because it's on the ground," said the mother. "You don't know where it's been. It's dirty and probably loaded with germs, and it could make you sick." The child looked up at her mother in total admiration and said, "Mommy, how do you know all this stuff? You're so smart." And the mother said, "All moms know this stuff. It's on the mom's text. You have to know it, or they don't let you be a mom," she said. And there was silence for a minute or so as the child thought this through, and she says, "Oh, I get it. And if you don't pass the test, you have to be a daddy." Wow. Welcome to Father's Day, 2015. As someone said, Father's Day is like Mother's Day, and the gifts are just as great. And that's true. And there are some fine dads in our congregation, and we want to honor them today. After all, it's not easy being a dad. Let's hear a little bit why. A woman wrote to a magazine to tell about an event that occurred in her life when she was about 18 months old. Her mother was out and her dad was in charge of her and her brother, who was 4 years older. She says that she had just recovered from an accident where she had some injuries, and someone had given her a little tea set as a get-well gift, and it was one of her favorite toys. Her dad was in the living room one evening, engrossed in the evening news, and her brother was playing nearby in the living room with a little girl who brought her dad a little cup of make-believe tea, which was just plain water. After several cups of tea and lots of praise from dad for making such a yummy concoction, the little girl's mom came over. Her dad made her wait in the hallway to watch this 18-month-old bring him a cup of tea, because it was just so cute. Well, right on cue, the little girl, sure enough, she came down the hall with a cup of tea in her hand and gave it to Dad. Mom watched as Dad drank the special tea and then asked, "Dear, did you ever occur to you that the only place that baby can reach to get water is the toilet?" It's not easy being a dad. Found out what it meant to be a spinning image when he tried to feed cereal to his infant son. Well, that reminds me, it reminds me of a story, a news story some time back, about a 43-year-old German man, and I'm not making this up, it actually was a German man, who was airlifted to the hospital after he fell off a second-story balcony. It seems this 43-year-old man was engaged in a spitting contest with his 12-year-old son. You have to be a male to appreciate the significance of that story. Anyway, according to the story, this father lost his balance, leaning too far forward, attempting to outspit his son. He tumbled over the ledge and landed on the balcony of the apartment below. Yes, sir, it's not easy being a dad. But never before has it been more important that we have good days. Never before. These are stressful times that require superlative parenting. Not every biological father is a good dad. And today there are stepdads who are facing the challenge of being a dad to children who may or may not be ready to accept them. That there are also grandfathers who are filling the role of surrogate dads. This is a new world, particularly with regard to the family. Today, we sincerely salute all of those men who are consciously seeking to provide a wholesome Christian environment to young people in whatever role they may be, just as we salute Christian women on Mother's Day. Dads are often called upon when the storms of life come thundering in. Our scripture lesson today concerns that time when Christ calmed the storm over the Sea of Galilee. You know the story from Mark's Gospel. Jesus and his disciples are crossing the sea when a furious storm comes up. The waves are breaking over the boat. It's nearly swamped. While this is going on, Jesus is in the stern, sleeping on a cushion. But the frightened disciples wake him and say, "Teacher, don't you care if we drown?" What happens next is one of the most dramatic scenes in Scripture. Jesus gets up, he rebukes the wind, and he says to the waves, "Quiet, be still." And suddenly the wind dies down, and it is completely calm outside. Jesus then turns to his disciples and he asks them, "Why are you so afraid? Do you still have no faith?" Then Mark says something really interesting. Listen to this. He says, "They were terrified and asked each other, 'Who is this that even the wind and the waves obey?'" The disciples were more frightened by the fact that Jesus could calm the storm than they were of the storm itself. Can you picture that? And they should be frightened. You see, Jesus was no ordinary man. Only the power of God can calm an angry storm. And Jesus had done just that. Christ is still in the business of calming storms. We need to understand that. Sometimes those storms are in our individual hearts. Sometimes those storms are in our families. Sometimes those storms are in society. But Christ is still in the business of calming storms. We need to understand that whenever and wherever there are people, there are storms. Would you agree with that? Wherever there are people, there are storms. These storms may be personal storms, storms raging in our individual hearts and our minds, or they may be storms in our social relationships. Either way, they can bring peril. There was a fascinating but somewhat cruel study done in Russia sometime back. Scientists subjected a group of chimpanzees to an assortment of experiences that made them violently and helplessly jealous. For example, they would take a chimpanzee who had been living happily with his family and suddenly rip him from the family, placing him in an adjoining cage from which he would see and hear the family, but he couldn't reach out and touch them. In full view of another
chimpanzee was given his place. And screaming with rage, he could only watch as his fury mounted. Within 3 months, he was dead of severe hardening of the arteries and of high blood pressure. He was killed by his jealousy and rage. You see, a storm within one's soul can have tragic circumstances. Jealousy, anger, bitterness, guilt, the list of storms that can rock our individual souls is lengthy indeed, isn't it? We need a Savior when such storms rage within us. But there are other storms, storms that may rock our relationships. These storms may be in our marriages, or between us and our children, or in our workplace, or in our community, or in our world as a whole. In the 19th century, philosopher Arthur Schopenhauer compared the human race to porcupines huddled together on a bitter cold winter night. The colder it gets outside, the more we huddle together for warmth. But the closer they get to one another, the more they hurt one another with their sharp quills. Pastor John Ortberg had a delightful discussion on this in his book on porcupines, in a book entitled Everybody's Normal Until You Get to Know Them. Porcupines are members of the rodent family, says Ortberg. They have around 30,000 quills attached to their bodies. Each quill can be driven into an enemy, and the enemy's body heat will cause the microscopic bar to expand and become more intense. The wounds can fester, and more dangerous ones affecting vital organs can be fatal. The porcupine is not generally regarded as a lovable animal. Ortberg continues on, and he says, books and movies celebrate almost every other conceivable animal. Dogs, cats, horses, pigs like Bay or Arnold Ziffel from the old TV show Green Acres. Spiders as in Charlotte's Webs. Dolphins like Flipper. Bears like Gentle Ben. And killer whales like Free Willy. Even skunks have Pepe Le Pew. But there are no famous porcupines. None. As a general rule, porcupines have two methods for handling relationships: withdrawal and attack. They either head for a tree or stick out their quills. They are generally solitary animals. Wolves run in packs, sheep huddle in flocks. We speak of herds of elephants and gaggles of geese and even a murder of crows. But there's no special day for a group of porcupines because they travel alone. Porcupines don't always want to be alone. In late autumn, a young porcupine's thoughts turn to love. But love turns out to be a risky business when you're a porcupine. Females are only open to a dinner and a movie only once a year. The window of opportunity closes pretty quickly. And a girl porcupine's no is the most widely respected term down in all of animal kingdom. Fear and anger make them dangerous little creatures to be around. Did you know that people can be like porcupines? How often, even in the closest of relationships, we can hurt one another? Even worse, toxic feelings have a way of intensifying if not dealt with at the earliest possible moment. It is not enough to ride out these storms. Someone needs to calm the storm. Someone, of course, is Jesus Christ. But how? How does Christ calm these storms? Let me suggest two ways. First of all, Christ calms the storm within us. We will not do well in dealing with stormy relationships if we cannot conquer the storms within our own hearts and souls. In the movie Dragon, the Bruce Lee story, Lee's mentor tells him this: you have to conquer the demons inside you, otherwise you will pass them on to your children. One reason we have conflict with others is that we have conflict within ourselves. We are often part of the problem rather than part of the solution. We strike back when we should be quiet. We disparage when we should encourage. We salt when we should be reaching out. We have to calm the storm within us before we can have satisfactory relationships with others. Baseball superstar Mickey Mantle knew this well. When he was interviewed shortly before his death, he had been a hero on the ball field, but not such a superstar outside of baseball. After his playing days ended, he checked into the Betty Ford Clinic to deal with the consequences of a lifetime of alcohol abuse. Part of his struggle involved with the loss of his son, Billy, who had died of a heart attack while suffering from Hodgkin's disease, a genetic disease which had killed Mantle's father and grandfather at an early age. In the interview, Mickey Mantle said, "One of the things I learned at the Betty Ford Clinic was why I was depressed. I wasn't a good father. I always felt like I wasn't there for my kids like my father was for me." Sometimes we have to conquer our own personal demons before we can reach out to others. Christ calms the storms first by calming us. Secondly, He calms the storm by helping us imitate His way of dealing with people. Remember how He dealt with people? Gentleness, kindness, forgiveness, never lashing out. Could we be like that even as we firmly maintain our own integrity? It's tough. It's real tough. We can accomplish this enormous task only in one way, and that is by walking as closely to Him as we can. Sometime back, the BBC produced a television series called Walking with Dinosaurs. It seems that dinosaurs had a good trick to improve their own safety. They would walk in single file behind each other, following the footsteps of the one before them. That way, any other creature that came across their trail would be unable to tell whether there were only one or two or a huge creatures, two of these huge creatures ahead, or a large herd. Are we walking closely with Christ today? In 1 Peter chapter 2, we read, "To this you are called, because Christ suffered for you, leaving you as an example, that you should follow in His steps. He committed no sin and no deceit was found in His mouth. When they hurled their insults at Him, He did not retaliate. When He suffered, He made no threats." That's quite an example, isn't it? The only way we can follow Christ's example is to walk as closely with Him as possible, to walk in His steps. But we need more than His words and His advice. We need His Spirit to come into us, making us a new person. Christ can calm storms. Storms within our hearts, storms in our homes, storms in our community, and in our world. This is very important. With all of my family here, I want to take this opportunity to say, and they can witness, that for years I went through life with many storms in my heart. Until I accepted Christ into my life, those storms were volatile. They were dangerous. They created poor relationships with my family and my wife. Today, God has blessed me with improved relationships. My family, my wife, and my friends. Because He changed me on the inside. And now I'm able to respond with gentleness and kindness and calmness It's said that surgeons invited to dinner parties are often asked to card the meeting, or worse yet, to watch the host card while commenting on the surgeon's occupation. At one party, a surgeon was watching the carving while his host kept up a running commentary that went like this: "How am I doing, Doc? How do you like my technique, Doc? I'd make a pretty good surgeon, don't you think?" When the host finished and the slices of meat lay neatly on the serving platter, the surgeon spoke up. He said, "Anybody can take them apart, Harry. Now let's see you put them back together." What's true of meat is also true of relationships. It is much easier to carve them apart than it is to put them back together. Christ could heal a separate relationship, but it is better if things don't get that far in the first place. We need to have Christ calm storms in our individual lives before they destroy us. We need to calm the storms in our families and our other precious relationships before such relationships are permanently damaged. In this final story, Linda Sledge recalls a day from her childhood that she will never forget. She was playing in the sand of a Hawaiian beach near where she lived, building towers with her little red shovel and bucket. She had wandered away from her parents. Suddenly, a great wave knocked her off her feet and into the ocean. She managed to get up on her feet, but the sand was flowing out from under her feet when another wave struck, and she had no footing. She cried out for her parents. All she could see was the vast ocean ahead of her. She thought she was doomed. Just then, two strong arms reached out from behind and pulled her to safety. And the voice said, "Don't be afraid." It was her father. He said, "I've been watching you all the time." Those are Christ's words to us on this Father's Day and on every day. He is not sleeping. He is watching over us. Why are we afraid? Have we no faith? If there's a storm going on in your life, won't you give it to Christ today? May God have his blessings to this world.